Friends, it's great to be with you this morning, and today we continue in our journey through the book of Acts, and today we're especially in Acts 27. We've jumped a lot of chapters because there's a lot of story about Paul in and out of prison after the persecution that started, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago. And the reason why we've called this Stranger Things, for those of you new this morning, the reason why we've called this series today Stranger Things is because we're looking at the strange things that God did in the lives of his people, in the part, especially in the lives of the early church, which are still having its effect on the church today. So before we get into God's word today, I want to ask you this question. Have you ever dropped something and smashed it? And maybe not even told anybody that you'd done it. Have a think about that one. Have you ever dropped something and smashed it?
Yes.
So you know what it's like to break something, and you know that feeling when you've got a mobile phone. Have you got a mobile phone?
Yeah.
How many of you have ever dropped your mobile phone? You know that feeling you get when it falls, because it always falls flat face, I don't know why it does, but it always falls face down, doesn't it? And you have that moment where you think, oh, it's all right. And then you pick it up, and you turn it around, and it's a cracked screen. It's like, oh no! It's like the worst thing ever. So all of us know what it's like to have something break and fall apart. And when you have that mobile phone and the screen smashes, there's nothing you can do about it, is there? You can't glue it back with super glue. It ain't going to work. It's not like the old days when you could do that. So we all know what it's like to have something to fall apart and when there's nothing to do. This morning, I want to preach and teach on a subject that's called Some Things Fall Apart. Some things fall apart. And I want you to hear what I believe is a powerful word from God. I believe God has given me this word. Particularly, I only give me words every week when I preach at the front here, but this one particularly I think is for us here in this 10 o'clock congregation. And I want you to let you know today it's a difficult word. And it's going to be hard for you to hear it, for some of you here. But I pray that it's going to be relevant for you, that God would speak to you through it and through me this morning. And if you feel that God has spoken to you through this message, after the service, as you're leaving church, just touch me on the shoulder and say, Kesh, that was for me this morning. Just so I know that God's word has landed on somebody's lap this morning. Okay? Is that okay with everyone? Okay? We're in Acts chapter 27 this morning. And I want to just go back to that verse 22, where it says, there'll be no loss of life among you, but only of the sheep. There'll be no loss of life among you, but only of the sheep. Do me a favor. Preach to your neighbor and tell them, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Sometimes things fall apart.
Amen.
In our reading today, Paul receives a word from the Lord that nobody wants to hear. He hears a word that says, Paul, this ship ain't going to make it. The boat that you're on is going to be broken. The thing you believe would carry you to where you thought you wanted to go, that thing is going to fall apart. And beloved, it's a reminder to us this morning that sometimes God allows things to fall apart. And I know that it gets quiet in church at this moment because that's not a word that you want to hear when you come to church. It's hard to hear the Lord say to you that something's going to fall apart. When you had high hopes in it, when you had dreams, when you had desires, and when you prayed for that ship, it's hard to receive that word, but the ship has been through so much already. All the storms you already made it through, all the counseling you went through, all the therapy you engaged in, all the performance improvement plans that you had for yourself. Nobody gets on a ship thinking that it's going to fall apart. If you knew it was going to fall apart, if you knew it would end like that, you never would have said, I do. If you knew, you wouldn't have given yourself to them. If you knew they would lay you off, you would never have taken that job in the first place. If you knew they would stab you in the back, you never would have befriended them. Because nobody gets on a ship thinking it's going to fall apart. What do you do when things fall apart? When you know all hope is gone for it to be saved? Well, as we get into God's word this morning, let's pray together. It's up on the screen. And if you've got your Bibles with you, just look in there, look at Acts 27 this morning. I'm going to be preaching from God's Word there. And I say these words together as we know that we will receive God's message for us this morning. I believe this is God's Word. It is alive and active. It is food for my soul and healing for my body. I am ready to receive the Word from God today. In Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, what I want to tell you this morning is when things fall apart, there's six things I believe the Lord wants to share with us in this passage. But I'm only going to give you three this morning. But it's my practice to give you three. If I had an hour, I'd give you six. But I'm going to give you three this morning, and I'm hoping that none of you will go to glory in the next 2 weeks, as we'll be able to come back and I'll be able to give you the other three in 2 weeks' time. So what do you do when things fall apart? It's a good question. What do you do? When you know all hope is gone and it can't be saved. Well, the first thing I believe God wants us to know this morning, the first thing I want you to write down is, don't stop trusting God. Don't stop trusting God. God tells Paul, he's falling apart because, number one, you sailed in the wrong season. That those on board the ship knew winter was coming, but they wanted to sail so badly and get to Rome that they ignored the signs and they still went on to sail. And beloved, sometimes you can want something or want someone so badly that you launch out and sail, even when God told you it wasn't the right time, when the time was to be still. This wasn't the time to say, I do. This was just the time to be yourself. This was not the time to start the business. But you wanted it so badly that you did it. That the greatest enemy of discernment is desire. Because your heart can want something so badly that you ignore the signs that God has given to you. God says, Paul, you sailed in the wrong season and you got on the wrong ship. Because verse tells us, if you go back a little bit to Acts 27, the verse 6 tells us that this ship, that they found it. That this was not a ship that God had ordained and put there for them. But they found it. Can I push it? When you try it your way, it never goes well. I remember when I was 12 years old, and on November the 5th in England, we celebrate Guy Fawkes Night, and we call it Bonfire Night. Okay? And we celebrate the day. Every year it's celebrated in a big way because a guy named Guy Fawkes decided to blow up the government house one day. And we celebrate that every year in England with fireworks and fires. We like fires because we're crazy people. We revel in the idea that someone would want to blow up the parliament. Okay? And so when I was 12 years old, my dad started to build this little fire in the backyard. And in, on the back alley, in the back street, because you know the houses are all together in England, they're like terraced. And so he started the fire and said, now all you need to do is fan the fire. You know, he gave me this board, he said, just fan the fire. Well, I was fanning the fire for ages and my hands were hurting. And so I thought, this isn't working. And then I remembered that my dad had a jerry can of petrol in the shed, you see? And you know what's coming. So, 12 years old, I went to get the jerry can and I brought it into the shed and I brought it over to the fire. There was still just a little sparks there. And I poured all of it, all on the fire, all the jerry, 5 liters of it onto the fire. Yeah. All the fire went up all right. It went up all right, yeah. We did have a good fire that night. We did meet on all of the street down the back alley as well. Because all, you know, petrol travels. It doesn't burn up quickly enough. So what happened was, the petrol, as it started lighting, traveled down the street. And it went down, I'd say as far as Bloody Oaks is there, and all along there was just this trail of fire. Do you know how many fire engines it took to put the fire out that day? I was never trusted with lighting fires ever again. No idea why. But you know, when you try to do something your own way, it always ends up disastrous. But here's the good news. Paul hears the word from the Lord. The ship won't make it. But you will. That when God's hand is no longer on the ship, on your situation, that God's hand is still on your life. And you ought to be grateful that even when the ship falls apart, that God has a way of sustaining and surviving your life so you can give him glory. that I needed, even when the ship fell apart. Anybody here been through a shipwreck in your life? Yeah. A real one, some of you. But others of you, a shipwreck when your family fell apart. A shipwreck when your loved one died. A shipwreck when you lost your job. There are all the shipwrecks in our lives. But you're still here. Because the hand of God was on your life. You could have drowned. You could have died. You could have lost your mind. But the Lord kept you when the ship didn't make it. He says, Paul, the ship won't make it. But you will. The ship won't survive. But you will. Because my hand ain't on the ship. My hand is on you. And if you believe that, touch somebody this morning and tell them, I'm going to make it. Yeah. Whoever is next to you, just say, I'm going to make it. Yeah. For someone, you need to be able to say that to yourselves. Because you've been through some shipwrecks. But my ship may be breaking up, but I'm going to make it. I may be by myself, but I'm going to make it. It might hurt like hell, but I'm going to make it. Because God's hand is on me. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:5, 3:6, seek his will in all you do and he will show you which path to take. So friends, when things start falling apart, don't stop trusting God. The situation might go bad, but his hand is still upon your life. The second thing I want to share with you this morning is when things fall apart, don't stop being a Christian. Don't stop doing what God has told you to do. Watch what happens. They're in the middle of a storm, and Paul says, we need to eat. Now, this is what I love about Paul. He's a man after my own heart. We're in a storm, and he says, we need to eat. That's what I love to do. When I'm going through tough times, I like to eat. Some people say to me, Keshe, what? How can you eat in such a difficult time? And I'm like, I can eat at any time. Any time is good to eat. Because I rest in the fact that God has his hand upon my life. The Paul said, if I live, then I'm here with Christ. And if I die, I'm with him. And I have no fear of life or death. And so I can eat in any situation in my life. I told you a few weeks ago, we were traveling to France, remember? And there was a big storm in the middle of the water. And everybody was being sick, and there were people throwing up and vomiting in the toilets and on this boat, and the kitchen stuff was all going from side to side. Plates are smashing, and the people are going this way, and then they're rocking this way. And I was sat at my table, and I was enjoying prawn sandwiches. I was enjoying beef sandwiches. My own family were throwing up all around me, but nothing could stop me from eating. And the same with Paul. Paul says, in the middle of the storm, we need to eat. Because I know God's got my back. It's going to be okay. But this is no ordinary meal. The Bible says in verse 35 that Paul took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. Paul took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. Now, if you read your Bible and you've been in church on Sundays, you ought to be having a flashback right here, because it ought to take you back to the upper room when Jesus gathered his disciples together. And the Bible says that when that happened, that the Lord on that night took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he commanded his disciples to take bread, to give thanks, and to break it until the day that he would come back. Friends, if you want to know why we share the bread and wine in church every single Sunday in church, here is the word of God right here. So in the middle of the storm, Paul decides, I'm still going to do what Jesus told me to do. To take bread, to give thanks, and to break it. Because I'm not going to let the storm change my Christian behavior. You see, the problem with so many Christians, so many saints, is this. That they allow their Christianity, their crisis, to shape their Christianity. That the minute the storm comes, the minute the things start falling apart, the minute all hell breaks loose, So they stop going to Bible study. They stop attending the prayer meetings. Some of them even stop coming to church because you're so frustrated by what God is allowing to happen in your life. And the very worst thing that you can do in the midst of the storm is change your behavior. You've got to be consistent with what God has called you to do. Don't stop praying. Don't stop worshiping. Don't stop praising. Don't stop reading the Bible. Don't stop singing. Don't stop serving. Keep doing what God told you to do. Because the enemy's deepest desire, when things are falling apart, when all hell is breaking loose, watch this, the enemy's greatest desire is not to kill you. The devil gets no glory out of your death. Because when you die, if you believe in Jesus, you go to heaven. There's no victory for Satan in that. But Satan's victory is found when he allows the storm to change your personality. And that's a word for somebody here today, because everything that you've gone through in these last years, you know has changed who you are. You look in the mirror, and you don't even recognize yourself. You've never been this angry. You've never been this bitter. You've never been this cold-hearted. You've never been this selfish. And you allowed what they did to you and the situation did to you change who you are. And the devil loves it when their ugly makes you ugly. The devil loves it when their mean makes you mean. The devil loves it when their nasty makes you nasty. And I'm looking for some saints that made a decision that no matter what my storm is, no matter what I go through, no matter what they say, nobody is going to change me. I am who God made me to be. I'm joyful. I'm peaceful. I'm happy. I'm generous. And no matter what I go through, no devil is going to change who God made me to be. Now the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord. When things fall apart, don't stop being who God has called you to be. The third thing I want to share with you this morning, when things fall apart, don't stop giving thanks. When things fall apart, don't stop giving thanks. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5, it says, give thanks in all circumstances. You know, when I'm relaxing, I watch the Discovery Channel, and I came across a program where researchers were calculating how much money the human body is worth. And they added up to the best of their ability all the enzymes and hormones and cells and tissues and chemicals, everything contained in the human body, and how much it's worth. They added up to the best of their ability all the enzymes, everything. And their conclusion was this, that the average-sized person is worth approximately $6 million. That's right. You've heard of the $6 million man. Well, I'm looking at $6 million people this morning, right in front of you. And that's just an average-sized person. Some of you look like you're worth $9 million. Your Heavenly Father put $6 million of worth into your body. So that's a new way of looking at it. You're not overweight. You're just more valuable. That's right. The Bible says, give thanks in all circumstances. The Bible tells us that not only did Paul take bread, but the Bible says he gave thanks in the presence of everybody else. You missed it. He's in a storm, and he's giving thanks. The ship is falling apart, and he's giving thanks. Things are not going the way he prayed, but he's giving thanks. All hell is breaking loose around him, but Paul is giving thanks. Because there's some people who've made a decision. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall always be on my lips. Is there anybody here who's made a decision that no matter what my storm is, that no matter what I go through, that I will still bless the Lord? That no matter what my situation, that I will still give him thanks? Is there anybody here who's made a decision that I will bless the Lord at all times? But I know what you're thinking. you're thinking, Keshalu, how can I praise God when my ship is falling apart? How can I praise God when my marriage is falling apart? How can I praise God when my job is on the line? How can I praise God when my family is falling apart? I'm glad you asked. The Bible says that when you take bread and you break it, that you do it in remembrance of Him. How can you praise God when things are falling apart? Remember Him. Remember the ways He's made for you. Remember the prayers He's already answered in your life. Remember the doors that He already opened in your life. Is there anybody who remembers what God has already done for you in your life? That can give thanks to Him even today, even amidst the storm, even amidst all that is breaking loose in your life, and say, Lord, I still praise You. That you can still, in the midst of your storm, lift up your hand and say, thank You, Lord. Bless His name for what He's done. Bless His name for the ways He's made, for the doors that He's opened. Bless His name because He's been good to you. He's been good. Is there anybody here who knows a reason to bless the Lord this morning? Friends, here it is. It's really simple. I know you had hopes. I know you've given it your all. I know you think you've been through too much to give up. But Paul says we had to realize that all hope of saving the ship was gone. And that's a tough word for people today. That's not what you want to hear when you come to church. That when you come to church, you want to hear that God's going to fix it. That God's going to make it work. That God's going to save it. But the reality is, sometimes God needs to open your eyes to the fact that things are going to fall apart. The winter has come. That nothing's going to grow in this season. But this is just a season to sit still and let God work in your life. But here's the good news. Here's the great news. When the ship doesn't make it,